Lightning Talk, last minute one. We're always welcoming those. And for our next talk, I would like to invite Thanos. And hey, we can see Thanos, and can we hear him?
Hello, can you hear me?
Great. Yes, we can. Fantastic. So Thanos is here to talk about the ups and downs of developing a high-power hybrid fuel rocket. And Thanos is a mechanical engineer student at the National Technical University of Athens and the team leader of the student rocketry team of White Noise. And he is a core contributor to Libra Space Foundation. And he's going to talk about the Kronos sounding rocket. Thanos, the floor is yours.
Great. Thank you very much for the great introduction. So, my name is Thanos. I'm the team leader of the student rocket group White Noise. And under the auspices of Libra Space Foundation, for the last 1.5 years, we have been developing Kronos. Kronos is a hybrid-powered sounding rocket. And its title is a completely SRAD and open-source sounding rocket. SRAD means student researched and developed, which means that we design, research, and actually manufacture each part of the rocket as far as we can go, of course, in-house. So, some general specs about our kind of engine. Generally speaking, rocket engines are distinguished between three categories. First, they are the solid, which you have solid fuel and solid oxidizer mixed inside the combustion chamber. Then you have the liquids, liquid oxygen, liquid kerosene. That's some examples of liquid fuels and oxidizer. You mix them up inside the combustion chamber, then the rocket goes up. So we are in the middle of this category with the hybrid one. We have a liquid oxidizer and solid fuel inside the engine. So, some general specs about our rocket. It's expected to reach an apogee of 3,106 meters, a max velocity of 0.86 Mach, a max acceleration of 10.3 Gs, and it weighs about 30 kilograms with the propellant, of course. So, the propellants are, in our case, 5.68 kilograms of nitrous oxide and 1 kilogram of paraffin. So the reason I named the talk the ups and downs in developing a sounding rocket, all of the 16 members of our team, of my team, actually, we are undergrads. We're engineering undergraduates, so we did not knew how to design a hybrid sounding rocket. So we started with a Mark I rocket engine. You can see a cross section of the CAD. And some parts that we actually manufactured, we have to overcome major obstacles about machining. We didn't have experience machining parts, but we also needed, we wanted to make the rocket ourselves so we can have a bigger chance of learning how to do things. So we designed the Mark I. We aborted this engine because it had major issues, as it turned out, and then moved to the Mark II rocket engine, a far greater design. Much more acceptable for the capabilities that we had, but also a stepping stone to learn more. So you can see on the left the PCS, as we call it, pressure control system of the engine, which connects the engine with the oxidizer tank that we actually manufactured ourselves too. And we have custom-made VAs, valve actuators, as we call them, because we have two valves on board. So the time came for the first test. We needed, before doing any static tests, we need to hydrostatically test the engine and the run tank that we manufactured to 1.5 times the operating pressure in order to be sure that it will work. So we manufactured the parts. You can see the parts on the left, the inside parts of the rocket engine. We actually made them inside the Hackerspace in Greece, which is the lab that we work to. And on the right picture, you can see the run tank. We also made it by ourselves, the bulkheads, everything, and the engine. So, yeah, we went for the first hydro. We pressurized the tank at 82 bar of operating pressure, of the 1.5 times the operating pressure, I'm sorry. And it held great. Everything was a major success. So we were like, yeah, now we go for the engine. And yeah, the engine went boom. So you can see seared bolts on the injector head on the right picture and the combustion chamber, like, with the bolts torn, where it actually was it had another half, but it cut it in the middle. So yeah, we went for a second iteration. That's the second iteration of the Mark II rocket engine, which actually passed 2 hydrostatic tests successfully. So everything turned out to be working great. So we have on the left side the full assembled engine. In the middle photo, we can see the injector head and the injector assembly, because we need to atomize the oxidizer before pumping it inside the engine. And at the right is one of the most complicated parts that we had to machine for the rocket engine. It's actually the graphite nozzle. It's the bell-shaped thing that we can see in every rocket engine. We had to actually make a custom tool for the lathe using a really high powerful laser in order to get the exact contour that we need inside the engine. So yeah, it was complicated. So we are really proud of it. Now that we're finished with the engine, so some words about the internal structure and the recovery system. When Kronos reaches the apogee, we need to recover it somehow. So we have 2 parachutes, a drogue parachute, which is deployed exactly at 3,000 meters, and the main chute, which is deployed at 700 meters above ground level. We've designed, manufactured, and tested successfully multiple times the recovery system with 2 CO2 cartridges. Actually, in the last test that we did, the recovery system was able to push 6 kilograms of steel, so it will totally push the parachutes outside of the rocket. You can see the assembly that we have, that we did at the left picture. And actually, with this system that we designed, we only have 1 energetic device deployment, the puncture of 1 CO2 cartridges, but we can deploy both the parachutes, because when the time comes, the rocket understands that it has reached the 700 meters that the main parachute needs to be deployed, and actually cuts 1 small line, and the drogue pulls the main parachute out. So we only need to throw the drogue out with only 1 energetic deployment event. So about the simulations, we started using some spreadsheets to do minor calculations and stuff, but it wasn't working, of course. So Octave is the savior of the situation. We use Octave to simulate multiple things. We have a lot of calculations about the pressure buildup inside the combustion chamber. We have our own model dedicated for this, about the pressure buildup inside the run tank, everything like that. Of course, we use OpenRocket, another great open source program about simulating the trajectory. And for the CAD, we use Fusion 360 and FreeCAD for the analysis also. So a big problem about being an engineering student trying to use open source tools. We don't learn how to use them in the university. We only learn to use closed software like SolidWorks and stuff. However, that turned out to be good. Why? Because we could compare the results of free programs like FreeCAD. We could compare the results of FreeCAD that we were actually learning and didn't know if it gave good results because we were using it wrong. We could compare it with other programs close that we used and knew how to use from the university. FreeCAD tend to be great. So you can see one of the simulations that we did using FreeCAD about the structural coupler that we had. First, we were able to validate the results with the software that we already knew. And then, of course, we used it for everything else. And now we do all the static structural tests using FreeCAD, and also a lot of CFD processing using OpenFOAM, which is another program that we use. On the left, you can see an OpenRocket simulation and the OpenRocket model of the Kronos 2. So moving on, as the avionics are concerned, we design and manufacture our own PCB, which is called the Rocket Motor Controller. It's the onboard process, the onboard avionics of the rocket. They control everything. It has multiple pyro channels, multiple instrumentational amplifier channels, because we have pressure sensors all around the rocket, inside the combustion chamber, inside the run tank and stuff. It's also used to be compatible with the PQ9S format, and we actually use the PQ9S comms, the comms board used in the Cubic satellites by Libra Space. So you can see footprint inside the middle. That's where the Sandbox comm is attached to. The PQ9S comms, I'm mistaken, in order to communicate with the ground station. We're now in the process of designing the 1.1 version of the rocket motor controller, which is, of course, a work in progress as you can see in the half unpopulated PCB on the top or the bottom left corner, it's gonna be a big upgrade for the rocket. However, so the control box 2, it's the classic black box with switches and LEDs that launches the rocket. We made a custom Raspberry Pi hat for the control box, and the Raspberry hat runs OpenFCT. Everything is designed in KiCad, of course. So the whole assembly of the rocket, that's Kronos. You can see the whole assembly CAD, a CrossCAD version, and the Open Rocket Model 2. We actually need to test the engine somehow, so we manufactured the test stand. So the Mark II rocket engine is expected to hit a peak thrust of 4.2 kilonewtons. So we need to have a giant scale to measure this kind of thrust. So we made the test stand with three beefy load cells and some random basing and stuff. So we need, so as to be able to do the static test. Finally, each rocket needs its payload, so as not to feel alone. So we actually, some guys of the team are working for the payload. It's a autogyro system. It has a freely spinning propeller on top and three fins to control its roll, pitch, and yaw motion. That's a sub project that runs throughout the team. So where you can find us? We work at the Hackerspace GR. These are some pictures of the space. We have everything there. Everything that I've shown in the CAD and the real life models is there. So if you're around Athens, you can of course visit and see every part of the rocket up close. So yeah, that was it for the rocket. I tried to fit every development update that's happened into some minutes. Thank you for hearing me, and I'm open for questions.
Excellent. Thank you. Thank you, Thanos, for this presentation. Do we have any questions on the chat? And if we don't right now, while people are typing or thinking about questions, I have a question about the next steps for beyond, you know, this version, beyond this scale of the hybrid rocket.
Generally speaking, hybrid rockets are great for sounding rockets, for this kind of category, not for bigger rockets that go into orbits and stuff. So the next step would be a bigger version of the whole thing. So a test platform, like we could call it, for even Kármán line approaches and stuff. Kronos is like completely scalable for this kind of apogees. It's actually that's the good thing about the hybrid, that about the hybrid engine, that you can scale it up pretty efficiently up to one point, like Ritz-Kármán line or something similar.
Cool, thank you. Let's see if we have any question, and if we don't, I would like to thank Thanos.